Brushes are available in a variety of shapes and sizes. Most are developed with a specific use or purpose when it comes to applying paint. In today's video, I'm working with Dina Wakley's brushes, using them to make both additive and subtractive marks, and will show you how each can be used to make more than one shape. As always, links to the products can be found down below. These are the brushes I'm working with today, and they're all from Dina Wakely's line. There's this very large 2-inch brush, got some Angelina on there, and then in the next in line is the 1.5-inch, and it's paired with the 1/2-inch brush, and those are sold together as a set. And then finally, these last four, the 1-inch, the 3/4, and then the number 6 and number 2 round are all sold together in what's called the short-handled set. I'm going to start with additive marks today. They're the most common, and I'm going to work with Dina's paint along with Finnebert Art Alchemy. Before I get started, though, let's talk a little bit about a brush, because part of this will be a factor as we go along. So obviously every brush has a handle, every brush has some bristles, and those two ends, those two pieces, are connected by this, in this case, silver piece that's called the ferrule. When you talk about a brush, you have the belly of the bristles. The belly is this middle section right here. Then you have the heel back here, and this is the toe. Really, none of that makes any difference. What you need to know is you don't want to jam paint all the way up here into the ferrule and let it dry, or even let it build up, because it'll eventually cause this to splay. Now, when you work with a flat brush, you can apply paint like this and press down, or you can choose to work. This is called the chisel edge. You can choose to work with the chisel edge. And depending on how you do that, you're going to get different sizes and shapes of marks. So let's start with, as I said, this number 2. And I'm just going to bring in, this is a 6x6 page. I'm just going to throw some color down. This is Dina's color that's named Blackberry. I'm going to put a fair amount out because, again, this is a 2-inch brush and it's going to require a fair amount of paint to do. So all I'm going to do is pick some paint up. Again, I don't want to jam paint all the way up here toward the ferrule, because ultimately that just makes for a mess and it's much harder to clean. So I've got a fair amount of paint loaded in the brush, and it's very straightforward. I can put it down and I can pull, or I can put it down and I can press and make a little bit bigger line. Now, if I think that that is a little bit less neat than what I want, all I have to do is go back and start to recreate it the other way, and I can make more of a rectangle. Or again, I can make more organic shapes like this, and each one of these, now I'm applying less pressure, so I'm getting a smaller shape. The more pressure you apply, obviously the bristles start to splay, and we'll talk about that in a second. Now, when you do this, you can also work with the chisel. So if I come in and I just ever so lightly press, you can see that I'm getting a little bit of the chisel, and you can see that there's a little bit of a separation in the bristles. That happens in brushes, and you can see that I'm actually getting that part of the pattern. Now, if I don't want that to show, I can start to make these a little bit more definite. I can also work on the chisel like this a little bit. There's lots of different ways that you can create brush shapes, and that's what this video is all about. How do we create brush shapes? So let's grab another piece and let's talk for a second about how much pressure you apply. And I'm going to do it with a couple of different brushes. So let's start with this big number 2, and this is just me pushing and pulling. All I'm doing is pushing down and pulling toward me. Conversely, if I come in here and I put this down and I press really hard, you can see that the bristles start to splay and I get a bigger mark. And that works across the board. So if I were to pick up, well, let's put down, let's try a different color just for fun. If I were to put down a different color here and use a smaller brush, I can actually get these bristles to probably splay a little bit more. The bristles in these, the bristles in the 2-inch are stiffer than the bristles in this 1-inch. So if I put this down and I press and I pull, you can see that I'm getting these shapes the same way that I did a moment ago. But if I put this down, let's pick up some purple, and I press and I put it down and I really press, again, you can see that you get that splay. And now you get consistently across both of these brushes, because they're both flat brushes, albeit different sizes, you get a consistently larger shape that takes on this more oblong look. So playing with pressure and playing with how you arrange the brush. Are you using the chisel edge or are you using the flat edge? Those are all things that determine what your shape is going to look like. Now, where it gets really interesting, and let's just bring in some of the Finnebert paint just because we need a little bit of sparkle and glimmer. Where this gets really interesting is what happens when you start to combine shapes. And by that I mean shapes that you make with these bristles. I'm not even talking about bringing in a round brush yet, although we'll certainly get to that. So I'm going to pick up, let's see, what am I going to do here? Let's pick up some more of the purple and grab another piece here. And let's talk about what happens when you combine shapes. So I can do this and I can start to create patterns. And again, I've got, they're not perfectly rectangular. I'm not trying for perfectly rectangular, but if I want perfectly rectangular, it's pretty easy to get, or pretty easier to get by, you know, going back and manipulating things a little bit. But where this starts to get interesting, so let's bring in a little bit different color, is now if I start to create patterns, and I'm going to lose track of where I am here. So now what I can do is start to build patterns. Now I've gotten a little bit gloppy here, and that's part of the charm some of the time, is you let that happen. And you can see that the color has changed because the Fenerbahce paint is a little bit more translucent than Dina's, which tend to be very, very rectangular. Excuse me, very, very opaque. So again, let's come back and pick up some of the darker purple and think about combining shapes again. You can stand around and you can kind of do this all day, and the next thing you know, you've developed this library of shaped patterns that you can work with, that, or overall patterns that you can work with, that take very simple shapes, and when you combine them, you get something far more interesting. So I've got these brushes off to the side. They're pretty well filled with paint. They're not going to dry. I also have some water off to the side. I could drop these in if I felt the need to before I stick my hand in this little tiny puddle of paint here. All right, so now let's talk about the round brushes. So this is an example of kind of a teardrop shape. And if any of you are familiar with toll painting from way back when, and I'm really dating myself here, all of those depend on brush strokes, or a lot of that really depends on brush strokes. And that's part of what we're doing here. So if I take and I load this number 6 round, again, I've got a point here, I've got the belly, the heel, and the toe, and I put the toe down first and press, I'm going to get that kind of teardrop shape. Now, I'm going to exaggerate that because I'm going to press a little bit harder. And then, now this looks like a flower petal. If I press a little bit harder still, and then I release, you start to see the kinds of shape. Well, that's a little bit gloppy. You can start to see the kind of shapes that you can make. And in toll painting, this is, I want to say that it's been a long time, this is called a comma shape. Now, I'm not getting a good tail on that, but you can see how this happens. And again, it's a matter of pressure. I can use very little pressure, and I can get very different shapes like this. I can come back, let's bring in some of this. I can come back, and I can use more pressure, and I can create these very similar teardrop shapes, but they become much larger. Now, where this gets interesting is if I want to use, rather than the tip of the brush, if I want to use the side of the brush, now I'm getting an entirely different shape. And how cool is this? You get to play, you get to monkey around with things like this, and it, if you start combining, so let's say now I want to bring this back in, and I want to start doing this, and let's do another row. And now I can combine these. Let's get that out of the way. Again, I'm creating really fun, unique overall patterns, and these have their place. So if I put these to one side and I start to bring in some of the samples that I've done. Oops, I just threw that in a puddle of wet paint. Oh well. So if you look at this, you can see that this was done with the chisel edge of probably either the, I'm going to guess that that was done with the 1.5 inches, and all I did was outline it with a white pen. It just creates another visual element on here. This is the side of the brush technique that I just showed you. That's what I did around the perimeter of this half round page. This was something I was just playing around with. Again, it's that teardrop shape that you saw me do with the number 6 round. And here is a combination of shapes made with, I want to say that this was probably the 1 inch or the 1.5 inch brush. Again, I'm using the flat edge, I'm using the chisel edge, I'm alternating the placement, I'm creating patterns and overall patterns, and each of those things goes into making interesting layers and interesting backgrounds that become part of a bigger whole. So up next, I'm going to pull out my 8x10 gel plate, and I'm going to show you how you can use the brushes to take away paint, which is really just a subtractive technique. And that's an example, that's what this is an example of, rather. It's a little hard to see because I use dark colors, but where you can see black around here through the paint, that's the subtractive technique. I took it away from the plate before I pulled the print. Subtractive techniques work well on a gel press plate since you can use the brushes to make marks in the paint before you pull a print. The process is going to be identical, except that rather than putting paint down, we're going to be picking it up. Now, the thing to be sure of is that you put enough paint down. It's going to take you a moment or two to do this manipulation, and you don't want that paint that you've brayered on to dry before you get a chance to finish making your marks or pulling your print. So I tend to use a little bit more than normal, and you can see some samples. So these were both done with Finnebert Sparks paint. You can see that there's a variety of different marks on here. I showed you this one earlier. This was the first one I pulled. I used a couple of Dina's paint. I believe I used, this is Peacock, and I know I used Olive, that's the green color, and I kind of brayered an ombre across the paint, the plate rather, and then just used the brush to pick some stuff up. So that's what I'm going to start with. So the other thing to bear in mind, grab my plate. The other thing to bear in mind is that serendipity happens, sometimes a little bit more than you plan for. I was messing around doing my thing this last time and I dropped the brush and I thought, oh, there we go, until I realized that it made some really interesting, very unusual patterns, nothing that I would have planned. So keep in mind that those kinds of things can work quite well, even though you didn't really expect them to. So again, I have two colors of Sparks paint. This is, what is this? Green Goblin and Night Shadow. I'm going to put them out and just kind of brayer them in an ombre because it's one of the things that I like to do, so why not? Let's get some out here. Remembering again that I'm going to put a little bit more down than normal because I need to give myself some time to work. All right, so someplace here, what have I got? All right, get my brayer and I'm just going to start moving this color around. Looks pretty good. We'll just move this all the way across. Now I'm not going to clean this because I'm probably going to want to come back and do some more with it. So this is the 1.5-inch brush. I need a piece of paper towel because each time I pick paint up, I'm going to wipe the brush off on the paper towel so that I get the maximum amount picked up each time. So again, the same kind of thing that I did before, except that now it's picking it up. So I can make those same kind of brush marks. Now the paint's a little thin right here. Let's do an offset row here. Maybe not as offset as I had in mind, but close enough. All right, and then we'll do one more here. Now I can come in and I can use the chisel edge to pick up some paint in a much thinner pattern. And then if I want to, I can even do stuff like this. And you can see that now I've created a big swooping pattern in there. Again, let's come in and let's pull some shapes, some rectangles with the flat side of the brush this way. Hope I've given myself enough room here. We'll have to start to veer off. Oh, you know what? Because I didn't allow myself enough room, then let's switch to doing them this way instead. And then that's going to give me, this time I didn't pick up or wipe off the color in between, but I won't tell anybody if you don't. So I'm going to grab, what have I got here? This is some index cards. So this is a black smooth and sturdy index card. I'm going to put one here and I'm going to put another one here. Oops, I just dropped that in there, so that might not look great once we get to the point of actually picking it up. Now because there's a fair amount of paint on here, my ghost prints are probably going to be pretty dark, so we'll see what that looks like. All right, so there's the first print. Again, you get a piece of the pattern because this continues on down the plate. And another one here. I didn't get enough pressure on. So let's, this time, let's turn this way. And then I've got a 3x5. I can, well, I don't know what that is, but we're going to ignore it. I can put a little bit here and someplace here. Here's another one. Let's stick another one in here. Now, like I said, it could well be that all of this has dried too much. I might have taken a little bit too much time. We'll find out in a moment. All right, let's see what we have. Ah, okay. So, again, I'm not getting a ton, but I am getting some interesting things. Now, the bear in mind, I could come in with a white pen and outline these rectangles, and now I have that kind of negative space going on. Because this was a fair amount of paint, as I said, the ghost print doesn't look as ghosty as they ordinarily would, but it still works quite well. All right, so with that said, I'm going to come back with these same colors because that's what's already, if I could find my palette knife, because that's what's already on my brush, and I don't want to have to muck around and clean things up. Okay. That's a plane going by. I don't know if you can hear that, but I can certainly hear it. It's a very small plane. I can tell by the engine noise. All right, let's go ahead and brayer this on. Normally we're not in the flight path. I have no idea what's going on today. Sometimes you just have to roll with the punches. Now, the interesting thing here is just as in, all right, so everything's covered. You know what, let's do this. Let's put a little bit of green here. Just as when you are working with additive techniques, with the subtractive techniques, you can start to mix your brushes. So I've got this 1.5 inches. I got to remember to come wipe this off. Now what I'm going to do, let's bring in, well, if I could find my other round brush. Here it is. Okay. So now I'm going to bring in the round brush, and I'm going to do that kind of pick-up side technique that I did previously with additive. And I have to kind of move along here because if I wait too long, I'm not going to be able to pull this print. And this becomes part of the challenge, and that's why, you know, using more paint can be a good thing. Again, I can use this. I can use the tip of this to get some interesting designs. So let's come in now with this really big flat brush. And let's pull some big rectangles or squares out of this paint. And then... So here's where it's going to get interesting. So now I'm just going to do all this kind of random stuff. This mimics what happens when you're not paying attention and you drop a brush. So that's just going to be very random there along the side. And this time let's grab a white smooth and sturdy 6x6 page that I think I'll put here. And then what else have we got here? I've got some index cards. Put an index card here like this. And, well, I can probably print part of a tag if I can't print the whole tag, and that's fine too. And then I'll print part of a tag here. All right, so let's pull these and see what they look like. Now, obviously, they're all going to be different because they're all picking up on different parts of the plate, and the design is kind of varied as it moves across. But that's part of the charm of doing this, is you get all this interesting patterning. All right, I can already tell I'm not going to be able to pull another print. So here's my kind of very ambiguous, messy marks. Again, this is mostly messy marks. It doesn't have to be fantastic. It just needs to be a layer. I like this. I kind of suspect that I would. And then I have this going on here. So as you go along, you can do these kind of subtractive things. Now, if you get inspired, there's nothing that says that you can't put some paint out here and add some with the brush. You can layer color on top of color, and you can kind of play around that it becomes this additive and subtractive thing. I haven't done that, but it certainly seems to me like it would be very viable to do. So let me finish up. I want to show you a couple of things. I'm going to work around this plate, which is still wet. So this is the one that I showed you earlier where I had shown you the background done with these teardrops that are done with that number 6 round. I finished it off. And then this is the one that you saw me print in the last segment where I showed you how to make the skinny marks with the chisel edge and how you can make the bigger rectangles with the flat of the brush. The more you play, I think the more the ideas you're going to get for ways to create marks with brushes. I think you're going to find it's a very useful technique to add pattern shape and color to all of your projects.